This call is being recorded. If you do not wish to be recorded, please disconnect at this time.
All flights on hold. We are currently checking in additional participants. We appreciate your patience and please continue to stand by.
All participants on hold, we are currently checking in additional sites. We thank you for your patience and please continue to stand by. Your conference will begin momentarily.
Your program is about to begin. Should you need audio assistance during your conference today, please press star, then zero. Good day, and welcome to the Zuffa LLC UFC 146 Dos Santos versus Mir conference call. Today's conference is being recorded. At this time, I would like to turn the conference over to Mr. Ant Evan. Please go ahead.
Hello, everybody. Thanks for joining us. Sorry about the short delay there. Welcome to the UFC 146, Dos Santos versus Mir conference call. UFC 146 is the historic first time ever all heavyweight pay-per-view event from the UFC. It goes down next weekend, Saturday, May 26th at the MGM Grand in Las Vegas. It's available pay-per-view starting at 7 p.m. in the West, 10 in the East. This show really kind of underlines just how good the UFC heavyweight division and the heavyweights in MMA in general. They're going through sort of a golden age right now. There was a time when the heavyweight top 10 was really a top 4 or 5, but now we've got 10 hugely talented heavyweights all fighting on the very same show. And with the Strikeforce Grand Prix taking place on Saturday, I think it really shows that just how big the heavyweight division is getting right now. On the call today, we have your co-main and main event fighters. The co-main event, former UFC heavyweight champion Cain Velasquez takes on UFC newcomer Antonio Bigfoot Silva. Cain has a great opportunity to get right back into the title hunt, while Bigfoot has been given a dream chance to make an immediate impact in the UFC after his impressive run in Strikeforce. It's a great fight between two guys who've got everything to fight for. Bigfoot is going to be assisted with translation by his manager, Alex Davis. Then to the main event, we have our world heavyweight champion, Jurjen Dos Santos, making the first defense of his championship against two-time champion, Frank Mir. Our friends at Fight Metric were kind enough to send over some statistics on just how great a main event this is. Fighting out of Las Vegas, Frank Mir is actually the most successful UFC heavyweight of all time. He's a record 14 wins in the octagon, beating everyone from pioneers like Tank Abbott to Brock Lesnar to legends like Minotaur Nogueira. With his win over Big Nog last year, some people are calling Frank the most dangerous heavyweight submission specialist ever. And the records from Fight Metric sort of underline that. He owns the first, second, and fourth fastest submissions in heavyweight history. He has a career 8 submission wins, which ties him for the all-time record in the modern era. And he's also got underrated striking. Fight Metric tell us that he's only one of 5 heavyweights in history to land with over 50% of his strikes. The champion representing the country of Brazil, Jurjen Dos Santos, is unquestionably the baddest man on the planet. I don't think anyone can argue with that. His boxing skills are completely unlike anything Fight Metric have seen in the heavyweight division. He's outlanded opponents more than 3-1, with 7 strikes landing per minute on average. That's the highest total in UFC history. And in return, he gets hit with less than 3 punches per minute in return. That means on average, he lands over 5 times more strikes than his opponent does. That's the highest differential we've ever seen in the UFC in any division. But more than just a boxer, Junior's got some impressive statistics with his leg strikes. He's the most accurate leg striker in the division. And as a wrestler, he's defended 85% of takedown attempts. He spent just 13 seconds on his with his back on the canvas. That's just 1 second less than the record holder, John Jones. So now I've baffled you with science. I'm going to turn you over for questions, and Junior will be assisted with translation by his lawyer, Anna Claudia. Thank you.
At this time, if you have a question, please press star and one on your touchtone keypad. Again, it's star and one to enter the queue to ask a question. You may withdraw your question from the queue at any time by pressing the pound key. I will pause for a moment to allow any questions to enter the queue. Okay, we'll move first to the side of Adam Martin with the score.
Hey,
go ahead, your line is open.
Thanks. My first question is for Frank Mir. Frank, it seems like everyone's counting out the bettors, the fans, Junior Dos Santos. You know, how much motivation does that give you to go in there and prove all the doubters wrong?
I think anytime you go in as the underdog, it gives you motivation because you're more driven to win when people don't expect you to. Plus, it takes a lot of pressure off your shoulders. We're not a lot of expected of you. You can kind of just relax and concentrate with the task at hand.
My next question is for Bigfoot. There's a picture tweeted of you. You're looking very svelte. You're working with Mike Dolce. I was curious what you're expected to weigh in at the fight.
Pezão, saiu uma foto de você que está aparecendo muito bem. Ele gostaria de saber como está indo as coisas com o Mike Dolce.
Está muito bem. Pela primeira vez eu estou com 270 pounds 3 semanas e estou me sentindo bem mais rápido, forte e preparado.
Things are going really well for the first time before a fight. I'm at 270 pounds 3 weeks out of the fight, and the things with Dolce are working extremely well. I'm feeling very light and fast.
And just one more for Ant Evans. When Overeem was removed from the card, was there any consideration by the UFC to change the card from the all heavyweight theme to maybe, you know, adding other weight classes on the main card?
Actually, no. As Dana said, this kind of all heavyweight thing, it wasn't something when we sat down in a room and said, hey, you know, what can we do to make this a little different? It just, at one point, there were the first three fights were all heavyweights and then a fourth, and then we kind of went, oh, wow, I wonder if we can get a fifth. And that's what Joe Silva did, and then it just created such a buzz. When we saw it on Twitter, we saw it on Facebook, emails and on the forums. Fans were just so excited about this all heavyweight concept. I mean, I think it'd be a real shame to have lost that once it all fell into place. So Joe Silva worked his magic, and that's what we did. We managed to keep this all heavyweight concept going.
Thank you, and good luck to all the fighters.
Again, it's star and one to ask a question. I'll pause for another moment to allow any other questions to enter the queue. We'll move next to the side of Mark Emmons with San Jose Mercury. Please go ahead. Your line is open.
Yes, thank you very much. My question's for Kane, and thank you for taking it. I just was curious what your focus has been the last 7 months since the heavyweight fight against Junior, and do you see this fight as a step back towards reclaiming the title?
Yeah, you know, just from losing it against Dos Santos, I mean, you know, you definitely want to come back stronger and come back and win every fight. You know, with this fight camp, I mean, just kind of what I did most was in the beginning, just took my time getting back into the gym. You know, and as weeks went on, just kind of picked up the pace of training. Try not to rush, you know, the training, you know, getting injured and stuff like that. So my time and it just felt great. I feel like, you know, with that long training camp that I've had, really got my shape back together, my cardio, everything. So I feel good.
Do you feel like you didn't show people who you really are? And I know you apologized after the last fight. It seemed like you really didn't get a chance to show people the kind of fighter you are.
I don't think I did, but, you know, just fighting against somebody so talented like Dos Santos, I mean, you know, that kind of stuff happens. So, you know, it's things that happen, you know, you just got to learn from them and, you know, just take them to your next fights.
And lastly for me, what kind of challenges does Bigfoot present for you?
Bigfoot's, you know, just a big guy. He has a lot of power. He does everything well. You know, he's good on the ground. He's good on his feet, punches and kicks and knees. He has good cardio. So he's a guy that's really well-rounded everywhere.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We'll move next to the site of Damon Martin with MMAweekly.com. Please go ahead. Your line is open.
Yeah, first question is for Frank. Frank, there's been a lot said, you know, already in the press between you guys back and forth. I know Junior had made a comment recently saying that he said you're not a man and things like that. I got to ask how you react to those kind of comments.
You know, I mean, obviously, you know, no one likes to hear anything negative said about them. But I just broke down on why he said what he said when he backed up on certain fights, and I looked at it. I have no issues with my man, so I guess I took it as just him trying to sell the fight and trying to, you know, to be a little bit more, I guess, stir the pot. You know, Dos Santos, I think, has done better as far as a fighter in the octagon than he has as far as trying to sell the fight. So it's something that he's new at and maybe not the most successful with.
Do you think that that's, you know, obviously playing the game a little bit, so to speak, that, you know, talking about hyping the fight? I mean, do you believe that he believes what he's saying, or do you think it is just hype?
You know, I guess I don't give it much thought. I'm trying to focus on what I have to do. If, you know, my opponent makes a comment and, you know, there's some validity behind it, I go back and look at what he said and try to see why he said it. You know, obviously I'll take it into account. But if it's completely off the wall, I kind of just, you know, shrug. I'm sure, you know, my opponents do the same. If I say something they completely feel is just propaganda, they just kind of, you know, roll with it.
And last question for Frank. Obviously, in your career, you know, you mentioned that, you know, the losses you've had have been, the last couple anyways, have been to really big physically strong wrestlers. That even though it was a knockout, they were big physically strong wrestlers. But in the past against strikers like Mirko Krokop, Anthony Hardong, Chet Congo, you've done very, very well. Is that an aspect people haven't looked at as far as your traditional past against strikers?
Yeah, I think sometimes it's overlooked. They just, you know, I think most people get stuck in like, well, you fought this guy, and how did you do against him? And this individual fought him, and how did you do? And they got to realize that, you know, A, B, C fighters, you know, we've gone through the whole thing before on who does well. You know, it sometimes comes down to style. And with my style, you know, I've predominantly done better with people that, you know, use more striking or, you know, or submission-based games. I've had to work harder on the wrestling base, you know, as far as control and position and so that's why, you know, if you look at my practices, they're geared towards wrestling more because I am so comfortable with the boxing and kickboxing aspects and also, you know, dealing with, you know, submission guys.
And one question real quick for Junior, kind of responding to that question with Frank. When the comments you've made about him, I mean, are these just honest comments you've made? Is there a little bit of hype behind him? Can you kind of explain, you know, there's been a lot more talk going into this fight than maybe some of your past performances?
Júnior, a pergunta anterior que ele fez para o Frank Mir foi perguntando para o Frank Mir a opinião dele sobre os comentários que você fez na imprensa antes dessa luta, inclusive o comentário que saiu no Prime Time, onde você falou que o cara não era sujeito homem. O Mir respondeu dizendo que o Júnior é melhor no octógono do que para vender luta, coisa que ele não tem muita experiência. E que ele acha que as coisas que você está falando não têm sentido, e que você está tentando apenas vender a luta. Agora, a pergunta do jornalista para você é, respondendo a resposta do Mir, você acha que os comentários que você tem feito são comentários sinceros? É isso mesmo que você pensa? Ou é coisa que você está falando para tentar vender a luta?
Eu não promovo a luta falando, entendeu? O que eu falei sobre o Frank Mir, eu garanto, o que eu quis dizer aqui com ele não é homem aqui no Brasil, é que, tipo, ele não consegue sair de uma situação difícil na luta, é mais complicado para ele, ele não tem coração para sair de uma situação difícil, é isso que eu disse e eu confirmo isso, e realmente na luta... Eu não gosto de vender a luta falando besteira, entendeu? Eu deixo os meus punhos falarem por mim no dia da luta.
I don't promote fights by talking trash. What I say because I believe it. I confirm and I stand by what I said. And what I meant by that remark is that I feel that Frank Mir lacks heart and lacks the ability to proceed through rough spots in a fight. That's my personal opinion. It's what I truly believe. I don't say things just to sell fights. I'm not a trash talker. I never will be. So if I said it, it's because that's my true opinion.
And one last question, if I could, for Bigfoot. Bigfoot, I know you recently switched camps back to American Top Team. I know you've worked with that team a lot before. How much has it meant to you to be able to go back there, and how different has this camp been kind of going back home again to work with the guys at American Top Team?
Antônio, eu notei que você trocou recentemente de camps. Você já trabalhou várias vezes com a American Top Team antes. E como foi isso de voltar à American Top Team e como está sendo o trabalho lá?
Olha, a princípio o meu time é o Tim Nogueira, Rio de Janeiro, mas eu optei em ficar na Flórida, por estar mais perto da família. Um dos meus managers é o dono da American Top Team, que me propôs um camp que trouxe bons wrestlers, duas vezes campeão nacional camp, o Steve Moco, trouxe dois holandeses. Então, com esse grande camp, eu preferi ficar na Flórida mais para a família do que para o Rio de Janeiro.
First of all, I'm part of Team Nogueira from Rio de Janeiro, but I live here in Florida. One of my managers is also owner of American Top Team. He helped me bringing in top wrestlers, one guy that's two-time world champion wrestler, some big strikers from Holland, and it's made things easier for me here, so I don't have to be away from my family during the camp.
Awesome. Thanks a lot, guys.
We'll move next to the site of James Bryden with Sportsnet Canada. Please go ahead. Your line is open.
Hello? Hello? Can you hear me? I'm hearing some echo. It's all good. Okay. Well, before I have questions for the fighters, I just had a quick follow-up for Ant. I was just wondering, you mentioned the Strikeforce Heavyweight Grand Prix that's this Saturday. Is it a coincidence that this is happening a week from the all-heavyweight card in the UFC?
Yes, it is a coincidence.
It is, okay.
But I think, you know, with Travis Brown and all those guys for the last pay-per-view, I think it just shows that, you know, the heavyweight division wasn't the greatest division like 6-7 years ago, but I think now it's just as talent-laden as even the welterweight division, which has traditionally always been, you know, where some of the best fighters in the world are.
Right. Okay, great. So my first question is for Antonio Silva. With the Strikeforce Heavyweight Grand Prix this Saturday, one of the competitors is the last man to beat you. I was just wondering, will you be watching it? Will you be rooting for one or the other? Will you be feeling any disappointment that it could have been you fighting for that tournament title?
Antônio, você vai nesse final de semana correrá a final do torneio do GPs, onde um dos participantes é o cara que te proporcionou a sua última derrota. Você estará vendo essa luta, para quem você estará torcendo, e você se sente desapontado de não estar participando nessa final em vez dos outros lutadores?
Não, sempre me sinto desapontado. Só perde quem sobe lá dentro, quem luta, entendeu? E não vou assistir esse evento, vou estar torcendo... Eu vou estar na torcida pelo ex-oponente aí, entendeu? Sei que é difícil para ele, mas acredito que ele possa ter o Daniel Cormier. Eu vou assistir porque, nesse exato momento, na luta do Ken Velasco, é meu Velasco. Infelizmente, eu vou só na torcida. Então, eu vou assistir na luta do Ken Velasco.
Yes, I do feel disappointed, but you only lose if you get up into the ring and fight. I probably will not be watching it because I'm concentrating on my own fight with Cain Velasquez. I am routing for Cormier. I know it's a difficult fight, but I believe that he can come out the winner. I'll be rooting for him.
Okay, and then can you make a quick comparison to the caliber of fighters that you fought in Strikeforce to what you expect to be fighting and facing in the UFC?
Você pode fazer uma comparação rápida do calibre de lutadores que você lutava no Strikeforce e que você vai enfrentar no UFC?
Olha, eu tive quatro grandes oponentes, entendeu? Infelizmente, eu não cheguei a lutar, porque eu sofrendo com o Daniel Alfonso. Essa luta eu não cheguei a lutar, infelizmente. Mas eu tive três bons atletas, o Fabrício Werdum,
o Fedor e o André Arlovski, entendeu? Mas eu creio que no UFC hoje temos aí grandes atletas, como o Kim Velasco, tem o Shane Carroll, o Anderson, que pode ter a mesma dificuldade, mas eu acho que hoje está um pouco melhor, está um
Yeah, I faced three great opponents in Strikeforce, Fedor and Arlovski, and now I get the chance to face a fighter like in the caliber of Cain Velasquez, and there's other ones like Shane Carwin, and they're all great fighters. It's always difficult. I believe that in the UFC right now are the best fighters in the world in my category.
Okay, and then just one for Junior. I imagine you have to take a very different approach against Mir than you would have against Overeem. I'm just wondering what adjustments that you had to make.
E ele quer saber se com a troca de oponente para o Junior, você estava treinando para enfrentar o Overeem e você teve que trocar para enfrentar o Frank Mir. Quais são os ajustes que você precisou fazer no seu camping?
Eu precisei fazer sim, eu trocar um pouco, trazer umas pessoas novas para me ajudarem. Eles são lutadores completamente diferentes. O estilo do Overeem é destro, né? E gosta e prefere manter a luta em pé. E o Frank Mir é canhoto e é um dos melhores, um finalizador no chão. Então, eu tive que fazer alguns ajustes no meu camping, mas eu consegui fazer muito bem isso. As pessoas que me ajudaram para esse camping estavam realmente comigo, me ajudaram muito. E eu posso dizer que eu estou muito bem preparado.
Yeah, I did have to make a few adjustments in my training camp, including in the people that I was using to help me to train. Oh, they're very different fighters. Overeem is right-handed, and he prefers to keep the fight standing, while Frank Mir is left-handed and likes to take the fight to the ground and get submission. So truly there were several adjustments to be made, but the people that I had helping me, they were truly with me. They supported me. We got through it. We made the necessary adjustments, and I can say that I feel very prepared to go into this fight.
Okay, thanks.
We'll move next to the side of Steven Lieberman with Culver City Observer. Please go ahead.
Yeah, just two questions. First question is for Kane, and the second one is for Junior. Kane, since your loss to Dos Santos, have you done anything different to tweak your training plan? And if so, what have you done?
No, I haven't. You know, just always trying to get better. You know, there's always room for improvement in every area, on the stand up, on the ground. Just overall, so there really hasn't been anything different.
Okay, my second question is for Junior. Junior, in the fight against Cain there in Anaheim, you had a kind of a quick knockout punch there at the beginning of the fight, which ended things early. Is that what you look for, or do you like to feel out the fighter and get a feel for what they're bringing and take the fight a little bit longer usually.
Junior, na sua luta contra o Cain em Anaheim, você acabou a luta muito cedo com aquele nocaute. Isso é algo que você busca normalmente, acabar logo com a luta? Ou você gosta de sentir o seu oponente, deixar a luta rolar um pouco mais de tempo para você ter uma noção o aonde o seu oponente vai tentar levar a luta?
Numa luta, a gente precisa estar 100% de atenção. Eu acho que, principalmente na nossa categoria de peso pesado, a gente tem que ter muita atenção na luta. Então, a minha estratégia, eu venho com uma estratégia formada onde eu acho que vai ser melhor para mim lutar. E eu venho preparado para lutar todos os rounds. Eu estava preparado para lutar os cinco rounds. Mas quando você vê uma oportunidade, você tenta aproveitar essa oportunidade. E foi o que aconteceu na luta do Velasquez. Me surpreendeu também que ele sentiu o golpe. Eu realmente lancei um golpe forte, mas me surpreendeu que ele sentiu, tanto que eu demorei para chegar nele. Mas para mim foi perfeito, porque para aquela luta eu estava... eu não estava, para aquela luta, para mim foi perfeito, o resultado foi rápido e eu pude aproveitar bem, então eu acho que foi eu só soube aproveitar um momento que apareceu.
You know, anytime we go into a fight, we have to pay 100% attention to the fight and to what's going on. I walk in always with a strategy prepared for a particular fight and always ready to go the whole fight. Against Cain Velasquez, I was ready to go all five rounds. You don't walk in thinking you're going to end a fight right away. And, yeah, I threw a really hard shot against Cain, and it took him down. You know, even I was surprised that that shot landed as hard as it did and that he went down. So much so that if you watch the playback of that fight, you can see that, you know, once Cain goes down, I take a step back. It takes me a second to swarm him. But at that fight, the result for me was perfect. Ending the fight quickly and the speed, it was really perfect. But it was the result of just paying 100% attention and seeing a moment and being able to capitalize on that moment. It wasn't the strategy that I walked in there with.
And just one more question for Frank Mir. Frank, have you tweaked your training at all to prepare yourself for Dos Santos?
Well, a little bit. I mean, with Cain Velasquez, he's more of a multifaceted threat. You know, I feel that he's an excellent boxer, and obviously his wrestling credentials speak for themselves, and his cardio to be able to go back and forth between the two really makes it where it's almost like how it is when you fight George or some of the other guys in other weight classes that are so great. You know, you mold into a striking match, and then you get taken down. If you think you're just going to stop the takedown, then you get punched in the face. So you have to worry about different offensive weapons. With Dos Santos, it's not so much you have to worry about him taking you down or throwing a kick. But, you know, he does these things sparingly, but he basically concentrates on his best asset, which is boxing. You know, but it's hard to argue against it. You know, it's like the old thing, you know, if it isn't broken, don't fix it.
Thank you.
We'll move next to the side of Rodrigo Ferro with IG. Please go ahead. Your line is open.
Hi, my first question is for Frank Mir. On the prime time, you said you felt Brazilians had something against you. Did anything particularly happen? I wonder if you could comment on that.
Well, you know, obviously after the Nogueira fight, I got my share of emails that I had to translate with Google Translator. They weren't too flattering. And then I figured it was just a very small group, but it actually wasn't until the video game situation came up when I was scheduled to play with Johnny Dos Santos, a video game, you know, with THQ, to help promote the release of the UFC 3 game. And so the day before, you know, I guess Junior had stated he received a lot of, you know, negative comments and stress from a picture he and I had taken 2 or 3 days prior at a fundraiser for children with cancer. And for whatever reason, that seemed to upset a lot of the fan base down there, and they let him know that. And so he opted not to play me in that game because it was too friendly of a setting because of the ire that I brought up, I guess, amongst some of the Brazilian fans. So that's when I realized to take it a little bit more seriously. I was like, wow, you know, if it really makes it to where he won't play me in a video game, am I really that disliked? And is it really that much of an issue? I thought we were just all fighters and competitors.
Okay, thanks. I have another question for Junior. Cigano, o Minotauro, ele lutou duas vezes e conhece muito bem o Frank Mir, né? Queria saber o que ele te passou do Mir para você se preparar para essa luta.
Should I translate the question into English, Ant?
Please.
He said, Minotauro has fought Frank Mir twice, and what kind of insider help has he provided you in connection with your preparation for this fight?
Minotauro sempre me dá bons conselhos para as lutas, entendeu? E como essa ele já teve duas experiências de luta aí com o Frank Mir, ele me passou alguns conselhos, sim, aí de como levar a luta e como seguir na luta. Mas eu tenho minha estratégia formada e confio muito, assisti bastante, ainda estou assistindo muitas lutas do Frank Mir. E tenho minha estratégia formada para a luta.
Should I translate that or no? And?
Yeah, you could be our guest translator. That'd be appreciated.
Yeah. So Minotauro has always given me good advice with respect to my fights. He's been a mentor for me. You know, as far as this fight goes, you know, we have talked about it, but Minotauro's not. But Minotauro's not you know, the sole source of information. Obviously, I have my trainers who are preparing me and who have devised the strategy for me, and I follow their advice as well as watching Frank Mir's fight and preparing myself in that way.
Okay, we'll move next to the site of Chris Pappas with 102.5 Nashville.
Hey, this question is for Frank. Frank, over the years, you've seemed to adjust your weight depending on your opponent, where you get larger when you fight the big behemoths in the heavyweight division. Now that the division seems to be leaning toward a smaller heavyweight, where do you see your weight coming for this fight?
Closer to 255 to 260, just because I think, yeah, in the past I did become obsessed with the strength aspect of it. But the more I learn about wrestling, especially, honestly, you know what kind of taught me a lesson was Kane. I watched Kane Velasquez throw Brock around like a rag doll, and I was like, well, I'm pretty sure in the weight room Brock will probably, you know, put up some impressive numbers. But, you know, his technique didn't seem to count against Velasquez's. And so it kind of brought me back into, you know, being well-rounded. Obviously, I've taken a lot from it. You know, before I used to do almost nil as far as weight training and, you know, and athletic conditioning outside of just, you know, your fight training. So I've taken a lot with it. But obviously, I mean, before it got to a point where I was training 5-6 days a week with weight and plyometrics and whatnot. Now I do it 2 to 3 times a week, and, you know, and definitely tone it down, and it's more or less supplementary exercising than it is the mainstay of my workout.
Okay, we'll move next to the site of Dave Diebert with Post Media News. Please go ahead. Your line is open.
Hi. Thanks, you guys, for the call. Kane, You've said that after your loss to Junior that the time off was good to heal some injuries, get your body well again. I'm wondering if there was any part of you coming off your first loss that really wanted to get back in there right away, and make up for a performance that wasn't what you hoped for.
Yeah, there was part of me that did want to do that, but, I mean, you know, the most important is to have my body, you know, 100%, you know, and then go on and take a fight. So if I needed the time to kind of get that going, you know, definitely that was more important than going back into a fight, you know, at that moment. So I think the way I did it now was perfect for me.
Now, you obviously, first time in MMA, but wrestling and, you know, maybe other athletic endeavors. Are you generally one of those guys who stews a lot and, you know, rethinks what happened and analyzes losses like that? Or are you able to, you know, deal with it, let it go?
I'm definitely able to let it go, you know. In wrestling, I mean, you know, I've lost, you know, matches before and stuff like that. So it's always a thing where you just kind of learn from it. You just watch film, but you don't really keep it with you. You don't always think about it, you know. It's kind of thing where you just learn from it right away and then just move on. I mean, that's what you have to do. I mean, I wasn't thinking I was going to go with my career, you know, undefeated, you know. You kind of expect to lose sometimes. I mean, it's the kind of thing that just happened. You know, he was better on that day, and that's all it is, you know. Right now, it's just getting ready for the next fight.
All right. Thanks, Kane. Antonio, how excited, how big a deal, personally, is this for you, making your UFC debut?
Antônio, o como é importante e o quanto é grande para você estar lutando pela primeira vez no UFC?
É um sonho realizado. O sonho de todo atleta é estar no melhor evento e poder enfrentar os melhores atletas. E é um sonho realizado que eu estou realizando agora, dia 26 de maio, para a minha primeira luta. E eu estou indo para fazer um grande espetáculo, e vocês podem ter certeza. Um dos aí.
It's a dream come true. It's a dream that any athlete in our sport wants to live out. And everybody can be sure that on the 26th of May, I will give out a great fight.
Are you more nervous? Or I guess how are the feelings heading into the fight compared to previous ones? You've headlined cards, been on the top of the cards, but like you said, this is what MMA athletes aspire to. Are you more nervous than previous events?
Você está mais nervoso? Você já encabeçou grandes cards, mas essa situação que você vive agora é que os lutadores desse esporte aspiram. Isso te traz mais nervosismo?
Não, de forma alguma. Eu estou muito relaxado, muito bem tranquilo, graças a Deus. Estou muito bem treinado. E é uma grande oportunidade que o UFC está me dando. De poder já na primeira luta estar enfrentando um grande atleta, o segundo melhor do mundo aí ranqueado, o ex-campeão, e é o grande favorito, e eu me sinto bem nessa situação de não favorito, entendeu? E sem responsabilidade nenhuma, sem ansiedade nenhuma, só quero ir lá e fazer uma boa luta.
No, not at all. I'm very relaxed. I'm feeling very, very well. I'm very well prepared. It's a great opportunity that the UFC is giving me to fight on my first fight in the UFC against one of the tops in the world. And it doesn't bother me at all. I'm the underdog on this fight, and it takes a lot of responsibility off my back, and I feel very comfortable with that.
All right. Thanks very much, you guys.
We'll move next to the site of John Morgan with MMAJunkie.com. Please go ahead. Your line is open.
Great. Thank you very much. If I can start with Antonio, please. Antonio, you mentioned that you'd be coming in lighter for this fight, you know, feeling very quick. I'm curious what the logic was behind that when it seems, you know, size has been such a big advantage in the past. Was that, you know, did you do that on purpose, or is that just kind of a byproduct of your training?
Pezão, você citou que você está entrando mais leve para essa luta. Eu gostaria de saber a lógica atrás disso, já que o seu tamanho e sua força tem sido uma grande vantagem para você. Qual é a lógica atrás disso aí?
Olha, eu procurei melhorar a minha parte de velocidade, entendeu? Já que o Caim Velasco é muito veloz, é muito rápido. Eu acho que ele tem dois grandes pontos ao favor dele, a velocidade e o wrestling. E eu tenho dois grandes pontos para falar, a minha força e o meu jiu-jitsu. Então, mas eu procurei estar mais leve, procurar me movimentar melhor dentro do cage, e a primeira oportunidade que eu tive é para falar o...
Cain Velasquez is a lighter and much faster fighter, and diametrically opposed to my strong points were my strength and my jiu-jitsu. So I tried to come in a little bit lighter and to be able to counter his speed and his lightness. I think that will be favorable to me.
All right, thank you. If I can move on to Cain, please. Cain, I know when this whole lineup shuffle kind of occurred, your thing was just saying, hey, I'll fight anybody. I just want to make sure it's somebody that's going to get me a title shot if I win. What were your thoughts when Antonio was the name that was given to you? Were you initially excited about it? What did you think stylistically about, you know, how that changed the fight for you?
Yeah, you know, excited about it. You know, Silva's a tough guy. He's been, you know, in a lot of fights with top level competitors. He's a guy that just does everything well. He's really well rounded.
And I'm curious, you know, and do you consider him a UFC caliber fighter? I mean, obviously he had some big wins in Strikeforce, but he hasn't done it in the octagon yet. You know, when you're stacking him up, do you consider him an elite level UFC caliber fighter?
Definitely, you know, the type of guys that he's fought. I mean, he's definitely, you know, deserves a shot up here. You know, with the UFC has. I think he's, you know, one of the best heavyweights out there. So for sure.
Great, thanks, Cain. And one final question for Frank. Frank Ant kicked off the call by saying this was kind of the golden age of heavyweights. I'm curious if you agree that that's true, obviously, as a former two-time champion. And if you do think that is the case, would this one be, you know, a little sweeter, a little more special, considering, you know, the type of talent that is out there in the heavyweight division now?
Oh, you know, I do agree that there are more, especially now since we don't have to worry about the weight class being divided up amongst promotions. You know, right now, everybody that's anybody in the heavyweight division is under a Zuffa banner. That being said, I've heard it before, though, a couple times where, you know, I remember when I was, you know, Shane Carwin, Brock, Kane were coming up, you know, that time Junior was there. And so there's been times before where it was heavily stacked and very intriguing. And, you know, I think when Brock was the champ there about 2 years ago, 3 years ago, that was being brought up again. You know, oh, it's a stacked division. I do think it's the deepest it's ever been. But if you're kind of playing around the top five always, then it only matters if it has five deep.
Great. Thank you all, gentlemen.
We'll move next to the side of Christian Chestnut with MMA Today Show. Please go ahead.
Yes, thanks for having me. First question is for Kane. Kane, it's my understanding that you've been training 3 days a week with Daniel Cormier. How do you feel that that's going to help you going into your fight with Bigfoot, since he just fought Bigfoot recently?
Yeah, just in the fact that he fought Bigfoot, you know, he kind of he challenged himself that he felt while he was in there. But, I mean, on the other hand, his fight with Bigfoot was so fast. I mean, and, you know, we're just expecting a different type of fighter that fought that night versus Bigfoot. We're expecting a guy much better. So that's the type of opponent that we're training for.
Okay. And for Bigfoot, to be more specific about your move to ATT, it's my understanding that a problem, you know, not a problem, but one of the reasons why you moved over is you felt like you had a lack of heavyweights to work out with at the Black Zillion camp. I believe you were working out mostly with the Villaforts and with Vitor Miranda. Do you feel at ATT that you're getting those heavyweight partners to get yourself ready for heavyweight competition?
Antônio, uma pergunta sobre a sua saída do Black Zillions para a ATT. Parece que um dos problemas que você estava tendo, que você não estava conseguindo sparrings peso pesado, você estava mais treinando com os irmãos Vireforte e Vitor Miranda. Isso foi uma das razões, e você está tendo esse tipo de treinamento na American Top Team?
Não, na realidade o principal motivo que eu saí da Black Zillions foi quando o Wolverine assinou com o time, e a princípio ele ia lutar com o Júnior Cigano, que é um grande amigo. Eu jamais iria ajudar ele para lutar contra o Júnior Cigano. E segundo, que a gente também está numa rota de colisão, mas cedo ou mais tarde eu poderia lutar com ele. Então esse foi um dos motivos. E aqui hoje, na América Top Team, eu consegui trazer um pessoal bom para cá. No Brasil, porque foi mais fácil trazer para cá. Deu bom aggressors, bons strikers da para me ajudar. E é isso aí. Estou tendo um bom tempo e me sentindo muito bem.
No, the real issue was that Overeem came to the Black Zillion camp, and first of all, he was going to fight Junior dos Santos, who's a good friend of mine, and I would never help a guy that was going to fight Junior dos Santos. Not only that, but us being in the same division, we were on a collision course, and that was just not comfortable for me. At American Top Team now, yes, I have some great heavyweight wrestlers and great strikers, and it's been really, really working out for me.
Okay, thank you. One more follow-up question. Recently, the UFC aired a really nice program featuring both Junior and Frank in the lead-up to their fight. First for Junior, it's very evident from that program how much avenging the loss of your mentor, Minotauro, is to you. And it's also very evident that you are one of the most beloved fighters I've ever seen in the country. Do you feel that that's added pressure going into your first title defense?
Ele falou que ficou evidente no episódio que mostrou do Prime Time o quanto vingar a perda do Minotauro para o Frank Mir é importante para você. E ficou evidente também que você é um dos lutadores mais amados, assim, pelo seu país. Isso coloca pressão a mais para você entrando nessa luta?
Não, eu acho que não. Realmente, o Minotauro ter perdido para o Frank Mir me deixou muito triste. Todos os brasileiros, eu acho, principalmente a gente que tem uma proximidade com ele, eu fiquei muito triste.
Mas o que mais me motiva mesmo para essa luta, para essa luta com o Frank Mir, é a defesa do meu cinturão e o bom momento que eu estou vivendo na minha vida, não só profissional como pessoal. E com certeza não tem nada de revanche nessa luta. A minha motivação é em me manter no momento bom que eu estou vivendo.
No, not really. You know, when Minotauro lost to Frank Mir, I was very sad. You know, I was upset. I think all of Brazil was upset to see that loss, and especially those of us who train with him, his teammates. But what motivates me is to defend my belt. You know, I'm living a really good phase of my life, professionally and personally, and my only motivation going into this fight is to defend my title, to keep this great phase that I'm living going. So revenge doesn't cross my mind, and it certainly doesn't do anything to make me feel more pressure for this fight.
Okay, one last question, if I can have the time, for Frank. Frank, in the same program, it was very touching to see how you surround yourself with your children and your wife and your dad, and, you know, as someone who's been following you for many years, I really saw, you know, a maturity and, you know, just as a man in Frank Mir. And I was wondering, do you feel that your maturity at this stage in your career really adds something to you as a fighter or has changed you from how you've prepared in the past?
Yeah, and I think also, too, it actually is more of an attribute to people seeing it more. My father's been with me since day one, and I've always kind of had the mentality with my children. It's been about 3 years now that I've owned my own gym just for the sake of reason having my children around. I think that's one thing I think was great about the show is people got to actually see a side of me that I think normally they don't see. You know, I think it'd be, you know, it's equivalent, you know, every time they interview me, it's right before a fight. They're going to see a different part of my personality. Then you're going to see if you see me at home with my children and my wife and kids, if you see me out in public. Obviously, I don't walk around with that mentality that I walk into the octagon with.
Okay, thank you very much for the time, guys. I wish all of you the best of luck at this very special event.
Thanks.
We'll move next to the side of Jordy Marin with Yahoo Latino. Please go ahead. Your line is open.
Hello. This is Jordy Marin from Yahoo.
Hello?
And yeah, it looks like...
Question.
It looks like we've lost Jordy. We'll move next to the site of Ryan Frederick with ToughTalkMMA.com. Please go ahead. Your line is open.
Yes, I have a question for Frank. Whenever the Overeem drug failure happened, did you change your mindset in fighting Dos Santos to a logical spot choice, or was it not until you came out before you started fully preparing for it?
I think I understand your whole question. We're kind of breaking up a little bit. When I first heard about the outcome, I realized that there was a very strong chance, if any chance, he would fight, that he would be taken off the card. And I felt that logically I'd be one of the first people to jump up. Obviously Velasquez, even coming off a loss, still has a lot of momentum going into it. So I was just kind of waiting for the confirmation call. As far as training, I actually started training for the 5-round fight when I first signed to fight Velasquez for two reasons. One, Velasquez is one of the most dangerous weapons he has is his motor, his ability to keep on going. He's the kind of guy that seriously, you could be winning the first round or two, and if he's still in the octagon with you, you better be prepared to fight hard. You saw that in the Chukwuma fight. He got stunned and hurt, caught by a very long-rangey striker, and he was able to grind through and take him down. And I think the stats that I heard last, and I may be wrong, the guy landed like 300 punches nonstop. And in fact, in the third round, he like picked him up to throw him like with some kind of freestyle. I think that's like a turn, just like a tight waist. I think just to prove a point to punk him or something. I don't know. It was pressing. So I was already training for that kind of cardio. And also the other reason was is that knowing that Alistair Overeem and Dos Santos were signed to fight on the same night as I was, and I'd be in the co-main event, if something were to happen to the main event, I would either A, step into the spot to replace an injured fighter, or B, was what I was actually most trying to prepare for was in case the main event got scratched. Me and Kane, we got selected to be the main event. Now I got to fight the cardio machine in a 5-round fight, but I wanted to get a head start on it.
All right. Thank you very much.
There are no more questions in queue at this time. Mr. Evans, I'll turn it back to you for any closing remarks.
Okay, thanks everyone for joining us for this conference call. We'll see you all next week. We'll be sending out the fight week schedule again, as well as the statistics I read out earlier on. And we'll see you on Wednesday for the open workouts. Thank you.
This concludes today's call. You may disconnect at this time.